Congratulations on the deal. Can you give us some specifics on which companies will benefit from this deal? For which companies is this better than what went before, the pre-existing EU-Japanese relationship?
Well, thanks for that. We've locked in all of the gains from the EU-Japan deal, but we've gone further in crucial areas like financial services. So financial services firms looking to operate in Japan will find it easier to get a license. It's good news for fintech firms because we've removed unnecessary data localization rules. And it's good news for business travelers. It's now easier to travel to and from Japan as business travelers. So you and I can work out that will affect a lot of firms in a very positive way, particularly in financial services, particularly in professional business services. There's also gains in agriculture and food and drink as well. So it's a very good deal for the UK. It's our first free trade agreement as an independent trading country in more than 45 years. And it's a very good thing. Liz Truss is in Tokyo at the moment, having signed the deal this morning.
Yes, we saw the pictures. And you mentioned financial services. So which kinds of licenses will it now be easier to obtain? Which part of financial services will be celebrating this deal?
Well, securities operating licenses in particular. So anybody looking to offer financial services in Japan. And as I say, also the data localization rules will bring big benefits to fintech firms like TransferWise and Revolut in removing those really bureaucratic and unnecessary data localization rules that Brussels sought in their talks with Japan. We've removed that, so that'll make it a lot easier for fintech firms.
OK, so fintech could keep an eye on that. In terms of the Brexit negotiations, UK companies trading with the EU are going to be facing some changes, aren't they? Whether that's customs declarations, rules of origin documents, animal health certification. Is the government going to compensate businesses for the higher costs at all?
Well, look, we're focused at the moment on making sure that businesses are ready. You're right that even with a trade deal with the European Union, which we're working to get, there will be changes on the 1st of January. The UK is leaving the customs union, it's leaving the single market. There will be changes. At the moment, we're focusing on making sure the businesses are ready for those changes that kick in on the 1st of January. That's the most important thing.
And of course, we're all focused on the presidential election in a broader sense as well. Greg, do you think it's possible still to get a US-UK trade deal in the 11 days that remain before the election?
I think that's very unlikely, but most importantly is keeping the talks on track. We're actually talking at the moment. Our fifth round of trade talks, FTA talks with the US is ongoing today. And we've been very keen to reach out to both sides of the political divide in the US. So I've been briefing governors, senators, members of Congress from both the Republicans and the Democrats to make sure that we keep that broad cross-party support. Notwithstanding what might happen in 2 weeks' time.
Yes, and if we do see a different result in 2 weeks' time, Greg, do you think that the headwinds to a deal will be greater?
Well, look, let's wait and see. At the moment, we've got a lot of support for the deal from the current US trade representative, Ambassador Robert Lighthizer. He is a strong believer in that deal, but we get a lot of support from the Democrat side as well, right the way across the political spectrum, in principle, for doing a trade deal between the UK and the US. It will bring great benefits to both markets. The US is our largest bilateral trading partner. For the US, actually, doing a deal with the UK will be really significant. We would be the largest economy with which the US has a free trade agreement. So it's a big deal for the US as well.
Can all of these deals with other countries make up for the losses in the trading relationship that look likely between the UK and the EU? Greg, I spoke to Annalise Dodds of the Labour Party earlier. She said that they can't, and indeed some of your government's own analysis suggests that they can't.
Well, look, I think the Labour Party is still fighting the referendum of 2016. The most important thing is we're looking to get that free trade agreement with the European Union. But look, this is a massive opportunity for the UK to build free trade agreements elsewhere. We're in live negotiations with the United States, with Australia, with New Zealand, and we're also looking to join TPP in 2021 as well, which will be a huge opportunity for the UK to join that fast-growing trading group of 11 countries around the Pacific. The UK, if we join TPP, the TPP plus the UK's GDP will be the same as the EU's minus the UK. So that is kind of a big opportunity for us, and we're really looking forward to moving forward on our independent trade policy.
Do you think the internal markets bill, with the possibility of the UK breaking international law, do you think that has made other countries less likely, less enthusiastic to rush to do trade deals with the UK?
Well, look, I think that's nonsense. As you can see today, Liz Truss is in Japan signing our free trade agreement with Japan. So I think the premise of the question isn't correct. And of course, we're hoping to get that free trade agreement with the European Union. You know, then it will make the whole passage of things like the UK Internal Markets Bill much more straightforward.